It's a very small group, yes. Are we on video already? Okay, thank you. Doesn't matter.
Go for it.
Yeah. His introduction is the first slide, so you want to say something about yourself?
Yeah, well, my name is Bernd Helmler. I'm the technical lead at Creative in the database team. I'm doing Postgres since 2002, starting during my studies. My favorite projects in Postgres actually are my migration and high availability and performance tuning. Yes.
You should speak near the mic.
Yeah,
so you can pick up.
But it's just the introduction anyway.
Yeah.
So I might need to introduce myself for the video. I think everyone here in the room knows me already. Just very, very briefly, all those dates given is when I started to actively develop software for those projects. So I'm kind of an old timer when it comes to open source, or, well, we didn't even have the name open source when I started. But anyway, let's keep the introduction short. Today, I'm more or less busy not doing open source software development, but running a company. Obviously, we both work for that company. And again, I'm not going to read you that slide. It's enough for marketing, right? So, when it comes down to power systems, we just briefly touched the topic already. It's a huge area that we as a community don't have that much contact with. And on the other side, all those users don't have much contact with the community here, as we can see from the empty room. Here are some quotes I took from Computer Weekly about power systems in general, and again, you can read them yourself. There are huge advantages, really huge advantages that you can get by switching to power technology, and we will see some of them during this presentation. One obvious is pretty obvious when talking about open power. Let me use a train as an example here. We all know that trains are, well, in general, safer than cars, despite recent events like slightly north from here. But looking at this train ride, I'm not so sure that that is safer than using a car. Similarly, in IT, we see security problems coming up from unexpected sources. Like, was it a couple of weeks ago when Apple found malware on their servers, in firmware of their servers? Which is something you cannot really check, right? It's embedded in your hardware. With open power, it's different. You can check the source code. With those systems, literally everything is open source. The firmware is on, I think, GitHub. And of course, you can use Linux then, well, you should use Linux. I don't think there's anything else you can do. For our systems and our tests, we stayed with the completely open versions and with Little Endian distributions. I guess you all have heard about Debian. The picture is pretty old, but I wanted to just give you a short introduction to what is Debian about. It's about different. Obviously, stable is the release of the distribution, but we have the unstable branch where all the development and testing in the distribution goes on, which migrates automatically to testing, which then becomes the next stable. I'm not going to talk about experimental and all those details because we don't need it here. The two important things for Debian in particular is we have backports. We just had a discussion like 10 minutes ago about running the most current Postgres on fairly old CentOS. I'm not even sure how old that one was. But it had version 9.2 in it as a distribution provided Postgres. And it's not that easy to upgrade then. Where Debian offers you backports in general in the area of the distribution, where maintainers just upload the newer version for the old stable release. Yes, Debian doesn't release that often, but you get the newest versions of the more important pieces of software to run on it. And at the same time, since the last release, well, the one that's out of end of life now, Debian offers long-term support. Or as the other one we used for our test, Ubuntu, which is based on Debian, does as well. The other thing that you should know is different in when using the Debian or Ubuntu packages, which are jointly developed, is we do multi-version, multi-cluster, meaning it's not that you install a package and you have one version of Postgres on your server and that's it. You can run directly out of the package without any manual adjustments. You can run a 9.6 and a 9.5 and a 9.2 at the same time by just installing those packages. All the infrastructure needed is readily available, which has the big, really big advantage that you can do a migration without really doing it in place, essentially. So you can run the old version and then migrate the new version and test the new version all on the same server, if you like to. Obviously, a distribution offers you, usually at least, only one version of a database package or any package. For Debian Ubuntu, there's a community-driven project called apt-postgresql.org. Apt is the Debian and Ubuntu package manager. And this is run inside, as you can see from the top-level domain, inside the Postgres project. And the idea is to give you packages for all Postgres versions for all Debian and Ubuntu versions. So whatever you want to have, just use it. It could be a developer version, it could be the latest stable, it could be an older one. For all of them are packages available just at, well, essentially the click of a mouse or the command line alternative. So far, available only for AMD 64i386 and Little Endian POWER. And also, I have to read that up. Yeah, it's stable for Debian, old stable, long-term stable, and unstable. And for Ubuntu, it's long-term stable 1 and 2, stable and development. For all of these, we have the 5 supported Postgres versions available, plus the current one, well, the one currently in development. Just do the math. You get 3 to 4 Debian and 3 to 4 Ubuntu releases, 6 Postgres releases, all the server packages, all extensions, all modules for 3 architectures, meaning out of roughly 150 different source packages, we build 16,000 binary packages. And that almost constantly. Every change that is done is reflected on those systems. That as a background of what we used for all the tests. Originally, I was planning to talk to you about those tests too, but then I could get Bernd to join me for the trip. And since he did the evaluation, I think it's better for him to tell you more about those tests.
Okay. I think that was on Slido. Oh. You already did. Okay, as Michael already had lined out, there's in the Postgres community, it's not only the Postgres database itself, it's the complete ecosphere. And with the PGApp project, you get basically all the helper tools like backup, high availability from one repository. And with the introduction of PPC64, Little Endian, you now have the possibility to get PostgreSQL with all its tools around into the power world. I skipped that because that's not interesting for this audience now. Why was IBM, or why had they decided to do the Little Endian job? Well, the big problem is that Big Indian Linux on power doesn't have the adoption at all in the community. You still need a commercial Linux to run on it. You can do a Debian Big Indian too, but the attraction on open source developers wasn't that broad. with Little Endian introduction, they suddenly have much more distributions available on their platform. That's Debian, Ubuntu, CentOS 7, Fedora, OpenSUSE, all deliver Little Endian PPC 64 packages. And for them, it's easier to do the QS for quality assurance for their ports. Another options are projects which aren't available on Big Endian at all. For example, prominent example, Docker. Docker doesn't run on Big Endian on PPC 64. With Little Endian, you get it for free now. I think Michael already mentioned it too. IBM decided to open source their freeware, one way in the past, and to get other manufacturers the possibility to license the power hardware. We get access to a fairly new open power machine provided by the German Thomas Krenn AG. It's a single 8-core machine with a complete open freeware. It's called the Opal environment. This one can be downloaded by GitHub. You can compile it on, for example, your x86 machine. It took around 3 hours, and then you can do all your modifications in there and upload the firmware on the server, and you can run it. For example, if you want to do some debugging or something like that, or code evaluation, it's possible to just cross-compile it and to debug it there. The machine provided by Thomas Krenn has 512 gigabytes of RAM, has a mega RAID SAS controller from Avago, and was running with Debian chassis with PGAPT. It's bare metal, it's not virtualized. The Open Power firmware can be downloaded. I have already mentioned it on GitHub/open-power. It's adapted by other companies too, for example, Talos, that provide workstation mime boards with power CPUs. You just need to license the power hardware, and then you can do everything you want, customizing and so on. The Opal firmware can be virtualized with KVM. You can either do power KVM, it's a specialized IBM KVM distribution, or you can do it on your own. We have also did some performance comparison on our 4-socket E850 machine with 8 cores, 8 CPUs, 4 CPUs, sorry, and 3.7 gigahertz. This is a little bit faster than the Open Power machine with 3.32 gigahertz. It has a little bit more, it's a little bit less RAM, 128 gigabytes. It was running Ubuntu LTS, but the main opposite is this was running virtualized on Power VM. Power VM is the commercial virtualization on the Power architecture, and it's not really called guest, but it's called an LPAR, logical partition. So IBM, that's the known of used by IBM. It's a little bit different than what we know from KVM, because KVM is a hypervisor which does everything. Power VM does just the virtualization, for example, storage handling or virtualized storage handling is done by the...
The LPAR is the same mechanism. Yeah, the LPAR is the same mechanism as the mainframe virtualization.
I think so, yes. Yeah. It's basically borrowed from them, yes. Yeah. The Power VM basically is a very small hypervisor. It's always running on such an enterprise IBM servers. You can mix, for example, Big Endian, Little Endian, if you are forced to run AIX, for example, together with Little Linux, Big Endian and Little Endian, you can do so. One advantage of the Power technology is the so-called SMT, simultaneous multi-threading. I mentioned it here especially because I have some numbers about it, what it brings to you. It's basically the same Intel does with hyper-threading, but IBM has put big effort into it to get more parallelization out of one core. So, for example, one Power 8 core has dedicated resources for up to 4 SMT threads. They can access, for example, registers or memory or CPU caches. without do interlocking. The Power CPU can do SMT 1, 2, 4, and with Power 8, SMT 8. Okay, let's some numbers. Let's dive in. I've used the PostgreSQL internal benchmark PGBench. It's also used by the hackers to prove performance improvements or performance patches in the project. I have slightly tuned the PostgreSQL configuration, mainly the biggest or most important ones like shared buffers, max and min wall sizes, and so on. TPCB is basically the known use by PGBench, but it's just a transaction throughput test. It's has nothing really to do with what an application does in reality, and but I think to get some idea what we can expect from the Power platform, that's the right tool. Each test database was 15 gigabytes. It was a scale factor 100,000 in PGBench. I mainly used prepared statements. I will tell you where the numbers are, where I used a different method. And every run of PGBench was previously done with PG pre-warm to get the caches of the operating system of the on the database warmed up. If you have any question, just raise your hands. Yeah. Because most of the numbers you see, for example, on the hackers list are usually done with 100 or 1,000, so 50, and it fits completely into the shared buffer pool. That's another. I've tried bigger one. The problem was that because I wanted to use huge pages on the Power machine, but Power VM didn't let me choose more than 16 gigabytes reserved huge pages on the bigger one. Yeah, I've talked with the IBM guys in Ehingen in Germany where the machine was located, but I didn't know at all what's the reason for this limitation is. But there is actually a limitation in Power VM. So to get all of the numbers in common, I decided to go with that number. And you want to be memory central just to scale the machine itself and not rely on storage or something like that. Yeah. Those numbers I present here are basically just to get an idea about the scalability of the CPU itself. It's basically CPU and in-memory performance.
And that's where Power and Intel architecture are different, right? The storage is probably the same that's attached to it, so you don't have to benchmark the storage.
You have much bigger caches on a Power 8 CPU than, for example, on common Intel CPUs. But the main difference is the memory speed. For example, OpenPower can up to 230 gigabytes per second, if I recall it correctly. If you choose the correct memory, that's. The bigger enterprise machines can even do more than 200 gigabytes per second. I think they can do 320 gigabytes per second. That depends on the hardware you purchase. You can go back a little bit. The reason why we have 512 gigabytes here in that machine is because the Centaur memory system in used on that Tian board, it's a board actually purchased from Tian, can do the full memory speed only if you have put all banks full. If you don't put all memory banks full, you have lesser memory speed. That's the reason why we have used here 512 gigabyte RAM here. Okay. Let's start with some numbers. That's a comparison graph. The E850 machine, the logical partition with Ubuntu LTS compared to OpenPower. Again, it's bare metal. We can see that the OpenPower machine is slightly faster even than the E850. this is one socket only. So the LPAR was restricted to run on one socket with 8 cores. So it's comparable to the open power machine. And we see it's slightly faster, the open power machine. That's not surprising because it's nearly the same CPU. The open power machine is even slightly a little bit slower, but it's bare metal and nothing is virtualized on that machine. The E850 LPAR is also using VOS, so storage virtualization, which might give here some influence. I'm not sure about that. We have to try it without storage virtualization here, but what was not possible on that machine. So we can do up to 450,000 with 100 connections and 300 and around 60,000 with the E850 machine, sorry, with 8 cores. To give roughly an estimation where we are here compared to an Intel CPU, I've had some graphs from a customer project from November with an Intel machine. It's using two E2650 10-core CPUs on that machine, and I've decided to put that number in there. The problem with that benchmark was that I only have three different client connections tested with that. But I think that's still enough to see that I have to look here around the corner, the 8-core E850 platform is performing a little bit better, starting with 32 connections than the Intel platform. And interestingly, with 32 clients, if you test that against 28 cores, on the E850 machine, it's even faster. I have to say that PG Bench is running on the same on the same machine with Unix domain sockets. The reason for that is that to be comparable with the open power, I need to use that because I don't have a second machine for the open power machine to test against it. But The Intel machine is always a little bit slower. Just to get an idea of it, you have 20 physical cores against 8 cores and against 28 cores. Any questions?
It's like you had before, was GBench also running on the same box?
Yes, it's always. That might explain the swan. That we have 64 logical CPUs and it's just decreasing a little bit before we reach that. Yeah. The problem is that you have many 64 threads and 64 Postgres backends.
How large was the fraction PG Bench was sucking out of your machine? Did you check that? So if you had 8 cores loaded, how much of that was PG Bench?
What do you mean with sucking out?
Well, if you have 8 cores dedicated to Postgres, everything is doing Postgres, right? PG Bench on the same box. How many cores does PG Bench eat in order to
It was always 1-to-1. It was always, if you have 100 database connection, I have used 100 PG Bench threads.
Yeah, but if you have 8 cores in your server or whatever, mm-hmm. if you use that, and if you run on full speed, if you look at the CPU load, how much of that was taken from PG Bench?
Well, the interesting part is, just give me a few minutes because I have another slide which might be interesting for you then. Okay, that's some detail. Okay, I have to get back to the red line. You can see basically that Postgres is scaling very well, about 28 cores. The Intel machine isn't scaling linearly, but much slower than the power architecture here, for example, just to get an idea. Here are some details against the 8 core and 28 core. Why 28 cores or CPUs on that LPAR? The problem is that, and that was told by the IBM guys from Ehingen, that the hypervisor and the VOS on the IBM machines use itself CPU cores. So it's a bad idea to use an LPAR which spread up across all cores. You have to reserve some for the hypervisor and for the VO server. That's why we have reserved 4 cores for them and 28 cores for the Ubuntu LPAR, and that's why we have 224 logical CPUs here. So we can do up to 600,000 transactions per second with 28 CPUs. That seems fairly good, I think. I've also did some comparison between Power 8 SMT modes and PostgreSQL because I was interested how big the influence of SMT and is to PostgreSQL performance. I've decided to go just with SMT1 at the start. SMT1 means basically SMT off, so you have only 8 CPUs available in the virtualization guest. It peaks out at 150,000. SMT2, it doesn't double, but effectively gets above 230,000. And with SMT4, you get above 300,000. SMT8 doesn't give you that much more as you might expect. The reason is that the Power8 CPU has dedicated resources for up to 4 execution threads, and with 8 execution threads, they are just divided. That's the reason why SMT8 gives just a slight improvement in that. I think Power 9 will go back to SMT4, basically. I'm not sure about, because Power 9 will come within different architectures designs, I think. There might be some Power 9 CPUs with SMT8, but I think they'll go back to the Power 7 architecture, which just provided SMT4. That's actually my information, what I have. I also did some comparison with older Postgres releases available in PG apt, basically 9.3, 9.4, 9.5, and 9.6. The numbers for 9.6 and 9.5 are basically identical because you have some noise from PG Bench and so on, but the curves are nearly identical, so I don't think there's much difference. The biggest difference, of course, is against 9.3. That might depend on the scalability patches which went in since then, but it's, well, remarkable that you get nearly 100,000 transactions more than with 9.6 than with 9.3 or 80,000. 9.3 has another implication here. It couldn't use huge pages. It's not there yet, or wasn't there yet. Well, the other, the 9.4, 9.5, and 9.6 instances all used huge pages. I don't have a slide for it, but I did some comparison. I have a slide for it, because the next one, and that might answer Hans' question. This performance test, because I saw that when running the benchmarks, the scalability benchmarks, I saw that the machine wasn't really satirized. So even if you run PG Bench on the same platform or the same host, it didn't really satirize the whole machine, especially if we get into a configuration with 28 cores. It was just sitting down and, well, it did something, but the CPU saturation wasn't over 60%. But Postgres couldn't do more, actually, and that's actually what that figure says. With one instance, with 4 sockets, so 28 cores, we're saturating nearly 450,000 transactions. If I start a second instance with this Postgres 9.6 installation, so complete another port, another instance, and run PG Bench at the same time against that machine, I get the same with both numbers concurrently. If I start a third instance, I get some lower numbers, nearly 350,000, and then the system suddenly starts to satirize. And with 4 instances, you see some fluctuation in the numbers, and that's an indication that the system is nearly saturated. And it was really, we had 100% CPU time used, and with 4 instances, the machine did 2 million context switches per second. So I think Alexander, yeah?
So did you compare this with the Intel machine to see the saturation level?
I couldn't do that because I didn't have the machine available yet then. That's, yeah, that's a pity. I really would like to do that.
Because the utilization of the CPU has been
less than Intel. Yes. That was really an interesting picture, I think. The problem with that machine, well, it went into production because the Intel machine was tested at a customer side and they wanted to complete their project. But yeah, that would be interesting to see that. This was done with 15 gigabyte shared buffer pool each without huge pages because it's always the same, like the number of connections. Okay. So minus C100, minus J100, always linear. I did linearly. I think my colleague Julian Schauder, he did some interesting tests with different notions. He, for example, using 128 database connection and just 16 PG bench threads, that gives slightly different numbers. I think the problem is, or the outcome of his findings was that you always have to use a power of 2 in PG bench because otherwise it's you have really strange results then. But well, PG bench is a beast, so. I also did some write scaling. The write scaling was only done with one socket LPAR with 8 cores with PG bench. You can do up to 32,000 write transactions per second on that instance, but you have to tune it a little bit. So the blue curve was actually max file size 20 gigabytes, and the red curve is with max file size, so the size of the transaction log, 120 gigabytes. So checkpoints play a role here. My colleague Julian also repeated the tests with aggressive wall writer settings, but it didn't give anything more. The system was still not saturated here. It was just sitting around and doing all stuff, but the CPU time was plenty still available, so. My other colleague, Christoph Berg, who is one of the maintainers of the PG App project, then asked me, well, what about power special optimization for PostgreSQL binaries? You can do some Power 8 optimization with GCC. IBM itself provides the advanced toolchain as a customized GCC build environment with a special or newer version of GCC on Ubuntu. PG apt normally builds with the standard distribution compiler in Ubuntu. It's GCC 5.4 with IBM Advanced Toolchain. You have GCC 6.3. And what they also ship is a specialized or an optimized crypto library. For example, you have a special optimized OpenSSL library in there and so on. And the compiler per default enables O3 optimization level instead of O2, what PostgreSQL usually does, and adds the MCPU and mTune options for Power 8, which activates some Power 8 tweaks like Ultivec options and so on. So he asked me to compare that. Maybe it's worth for PG App to get also some optimization in their build environment. The outcome was actually for that benchmark run, that's PG Bench without SSL or other things, it's just plain transaction throughput, it doesn't matter. If you use a plain GCC or IBM toolchain, advanced toolchain, you don't get any difference. That might depend, of course, on the workload. If you're using SSL connection, for example, you might get a benefit from it. SSL itself for transaction throughput tests is, well, you are saturating the data. The database drops out at or nearly 150,000 transactions per second if you use SSL, for example. SSL has a huge impact on the CPU. So it might be worth to do that with an SSL benchmark. So what about AIX? We have plenty of people, or I know plenty of people which are still using AIX on the Power platform. I've did some comparison with AIX 7.1. It's basically the same environment, the same storage on the E850 machine than the Linux tests. The problem with AIX, and even the experts at IBM had a hard time to figure out to get higher transaction rates out from Postgres on that platform. It's really difficult to tune. So here's a small excerpt what we have tried. First at all, use GCC. If you are wanted to use a Postgres on the AIX, XLZ doesn't like Postgres at the moment. I think there are patches around from Konstantin Krisnik. He reported that on Hackers that there are some deadlocks with the XLZ compiler and provided some patches. I haven't tried it, unfortunately. You have to make sure to build in object mode 64, so you get 64-bit XCOF binaries. The XCOF binaries allow you to tune some to set some tweaks into your binary after compilation. That's done with the ldedit command. I was advised to use the fork policy core. I'm really not an AIX expert, but I believe that guy. And that's especially important for PGBench. You have to export malloc options multi-heap, because otherwise, when you use PGBench threads, AIX always uses one dedicated heap for the threads. So every thread which is modifying the heap has to wait for each other. The default setting is 32, for example, so you are safe, but if you make it too large, you have a problem that the maintenance of all thread heaps is costly, so you have to get some tweaks to find the right balance. That's what we have done with recommendation from an AIX kernel guy in the USA, and the schedule command to force some special scheduling policy in the AIX kernel. The bottom line is it's much easier for Little Endian Postgres. But if you are still want to use AIX, it's better to use packages like Michael Pertzel from Germany has a special AIX repository available where all the Postgres stuff is put into RPMs and you can easily install it with Yum, for example, on AIX. So long story short outcome, that's a comparison between the E850 8-core LPAR instance AIX versus Linux. Again, same benchmark, scale factor 1000. PostgreSQL configuration was completely the same, except that AIX didn't use huge pages there. Yeah, I think that shows everything. And that's even a tweaked binary. So it drops out nearly 200,000 transactions compared to 350,000 transactions per second. But again, the system is not satirized, even under AIX. So I have no idea what it is, actually. A kernel guy had a look on some traces on AIX, and he suspected that he has something to do with inter-process communication. I think there was also a thread on Hackers telling that the mmap implementation under AIX is suboptimal, because every time you do an unmap on an mmapped region, which is our shared buffer pool basically, you have to put a lock on it. I have done some tweaks to relax that a little bit. That's the legend says about all about it. It's the red alias option. It was set to 200 in the AIX kernel, but it didn't give that much benefit. It's a slightly plus compared to the other results, but the problem is it lies all between 10%, and everything between 10% is for me like PGBench noise a little bit. So you have to take that carefully. Yeah. So bottom line, actually, from my findings, is yes?
This prior benchmark, is that a public information?
Well,
does IBM, would you get in trouble if somebody used this? Does IBM allow competitive benchmarking?
I have to talk with that guys for
this
that.
This is interesting information,
yes.
Right? That's indeed okay to use, I'd love to use it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, so this is specifically because of AIX being involved.
Yes. So IBM does know about those benchmarks, and they do know that we are presenting them here.
They know that. Yeah, they know that, of course.
One of those guys told me actually that they know that AIX is slower.
Yes.
I talked to one guy the other week, and they know that AIX is slower.
So
on AIX is lower.
But a big part of the market is to be with Linux, Docker, and all of those. So maybe that's where they want people to go.
Yeah, that's yeah. Actually my outcome too. So my opinion is with PPC 64, Little Endian, you get basically everything from the open source world, and you are open with that architecture. I think what Power is, I think, more prominent in Germany than actually in other countries. I know many companies, for example, are dedicated to SAP HANA, for example, and they run on Big Endian, SUSE, but they also want to use other open source project for their IT infrastructure. And
the
with that,
the missing thing is China. They don't want to use Intel, they want to use open source.
China was, I've heard, or an IBM guy told me that China was one of the first countries which purchased a Power license.
Right, exactly. So yeah. IBM made it completely open source so that all the Chinese hardware companies start to build their own hardware and go on a completely different performance, cost curve. And but then on the other side, Google is also evaluating the open Power hardware because they have special interconnects to GPUs inside the same subsystem.
Yeah, they are part of the open Power Foundation,
yep.
Right?
Yeah.
Absolutely. And the other thing, maybe should, before we finish, because we are running out of time, right?
5 minutes.
We have 5 minutes.
The way I understand it is, if I put kind of the same money on the table for an open Power system and for an Intel system, I get more performance out of the open Power system, right?
If you look into where's the number? You get with, I don't have the open Power machine here because I didn't have the possibility to do that test again with the open Power machine. The open Power machine was traveling through Germany to different customer sites, so I have only small time slots to do my benchmark there.
There are not that many machines available right now.
Where's the
locality, right?
That was too fast. So it's with just 8 physical cores, it's much faster. You get nearly 400,000 transactions per second.
But this is comparing to.
Yeah, no, I'm just interested in the blue line, and with Intel, you get with 32 nearly 150,000, with 64 200,000. So it's slower, yes, in that comparison with that Intel CPU.
So essentially, you get more bang for your bucks.
Yes.
It just means more work to get the machine running. That was my impression. I mean, just if you buy the metal, how much labor do you have to put into the thing to?
Yeah, it depends. If you're using Power VM, for example, on a big enterprise machine, it's getting more difficult. But I think the smaller open Power machines you get from IBM are fairly easy to use. I have talked with some guys from Thomas Crane, which are implementing that machine, and he says it's not that big of a problem.
So essentially, those open Power machines run on Linux, right?
Yeah, because I heard talking in Switzerland, I think 1 or 2 years ago, and it felt like crazy to get stuff
On what machine was that?
It was some power talk, and that feeling that having Linux installed and everything like that required some labor input.
We have customers still using the old Power 7 machines, and I didn't hear anything about that. It's really hard to get it running.
Maybe his contact was one of the first to try Linux on OpenPower.
Maybe that might be possible. Yes.
The firmware wasn't up to the point where it is right now.
I've compiled it on my Fedora workstation at work. It took 3 hours and it worked. So. Yes.
About 6 months ago, IBM released their new C mainframe, and the full time one was designed to run 1,000 documents in one machine. And then they had a hardware encryption board for banks so that you can offload all the encryption to specialties.
The Power 9 CPU, for example, gets hardware compression, which Postgres might benefit to with LZ4.
Done with the time. Any other questions? Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much.